In the coming videos, we're going to be talking a lot about eigenvalues and eigenvectors, and we're going to see a whole lot of these on the screen. And so I just wanted to kind of take a minute and talk about what we can learn from these so that when you look at them, you know what you're looking at and understand what kind of information we can pull out of them. Okay, so let's pretend like we have a 6x6 system here. So we've got A minus lambda B times our chi vector equals 0, and this is a 6x6 matrix, and this is a 6x6, okay? So out of a 6x6 system, and I guess I should have parentheses right here, out of a 6x6 system, we're going to get 6 eigenvalues and 6 eigenvectors, okay? So we're going to plug this into our eigensolver, and out come 6 eigenvalues and eigenvectors. So I'm just going to say, here are my eigenvalues, 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6. And for each of those eigenvalues, I'm going to have a eigenvector that has 6 components. So we'll have 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6 components for each of these eigenvectors. Okay, so that top line is the eigenvalues. So here's our eigenvalues, and we'll have 6 of those. And then these are our 6 eigenvectors. Okay, so each of these eigenvalues, actually these eigenvalues are gonna come out in pairs. So so like these two might be a pair, and these two might be a pair, and these two might be a pair. Now, each of these eigenvalues and its associated eigenvector are a single solution that satisfy this equation. Okay, this was our fundamental equation, our eigenproblem, and we're coming up here with 6 solutions to this. Okay, so one of the solutions is, if this is the eigenvalue here, that would go right in here, and if you plugged in this eigenvector right in here, then this satisfies this set of equations, okay? But there are 6 different solutions here, and there's no guarantee in what order these are going to come out of the solver. So so the eigensolver is going to spit out 6 different eigenvalues and 6 different eigenvectors, but there's no particular order that those are going to come out. Now, maybe there is some kind of convention in how they like to order them, but there's really no guarantee in how they're going to come out. So you shouldn't be worried about the order that these come out, but we can look at them and learn a lot of information. So each of them, but they are going to come out in pairs, okay? So there will always be 2 eigenvalues that are associated with each other, okay? So if one of these eigenvalues is complex, its complex conjugate is going to be its pair, okay? So we might have a time where we have actually 2 different complex conjugates, for example, and so those are easy to pair. You can look at those values and you recognize that you know these two are complex conjugates, so they naturally go together in a pair. These two are complex conjugates; they naturally go together in a pair. Now, sometimes if they come out as real values instead of complex, it's still going to have a real counterpart, but they're going to be 2 different numbers. So we'll probably, you know, we could have some real number here and some real number here. And it's harder for us to know that those actually belong together, that those form a pair here without pairing up the other ones. So it takes a little bit of work to kind of look through the list of eigenvalues that you get out and put, you know, pair up the ones that make sense. And then the ones that are left over, you can also make pairs out of, you know. It just takes a little bit of work to figure out which ones go with which, but they always come out in sets of 2. Okay. Okay. So the eigenvalues hold the information for the frequency and damping of a mode. Okay. So for each of these eigenvalues, basically, they represent one of the modes, and its associated eigenvector. This tells us about one of the modes, one of the dynamic modes of this system, and the eigenvalue contains the frequency and damping information. We've talked about how we can compute that. If we know the eigenvalue, then we've talked about the equations to compute the frequency and damping of that mode. The eigenvector, on the other hand, so let's this vector here tells us about the actual independent variables in this system and how they are moving in this mode. So it actually tells us about the motion or the dynamics of the independent variables. And this will all make more sense in the coming videos as we dig into each of these a little bit more. But so for example, in this particular example, we had a 6x6 system. So we had six different independent variables. And we have components of this eigenvector here that, and each of these components correspond to one of these independent variables. And so by looking at this eigenvector, we're going to be able to understand the dynamics of what's actually happening. And what we can do is actually we can put these in terms of amplitude and phase. So we'll be able to understand how one of the dynamic variables is moving relative to another one of the dynamic or one of the independent variables, how they're moving relative to each other, because we can look at their relative amplitudes and phases, okay? Now, these eigenvectors we mentioned previously are not unique. We can actually multiply this vector by any scalar, any constant, and that will still give us a solution that satisfies these equations up here with the associated lambda, so or with the associated eigenvalue. Okay, so these are actually not unique, but their relative magnitudes to each other are. Okay, so that's what we're most concerned about, is the relative magnitude of these variables relative to each other within this vector. And so what we traditionally like to do is we like to find the largest, we can find the magnitude of each of these and then sort them by the largest. So we'll find the largest, let's say that this is the largest component in this vector after we've looked at the magnitude of each component. And then we can multiply this entire vector by the complex conjugate of the largest component here. And that will make this component real, okay? And then all of these phases, and then we can compute the phase and the amplitude of each of the other components, and the phases will be relative to this largest component in here. So we'll talk more about this as we go through, but I just wanted to give you an overview of, you know, we're gonna be looking at a lot of these eigenvalues and vectors, just wanted you to be able to kind of digest what's going on. Now, one last thing I want to mention is that these eigenvalues, there's four different types of motion that they can describe, okay? So if it's real and negative, so meaning that the imaginary portion is zero and the real portion is negative, that's a damped non-oscillatory mode, and it's going to correspond to motion that looks like this, okay? So this is real and negative. Okay, if it's real and positive, and again, this is the eigenvector, or excuse me, the eigenvalue. If it's real and positive, that actually represents a divergent mode. So this is a convergent mode, and this is a divergent mode, but it's not oscillatory. Neither of these are oscillatory because their imaginary components are zero, okay? So we can tell if it's a convergent mode or a divergent mode, meaning that this motion is going to converge back to some steady state, or if it's going to diverge away from its equilibrium position. We can tell that by the sign of the real portion of this eigenvalue, okay? Now, if the eigenvalue is complex and the real portion is negative, then we're going to have a convergent mode, but it will be oscillatory, okay? So this is imaginary or complex, but the real part is negative. Then we're going to have this oscillatory motion that is convergent, okay? So this would be like the amplitude is decreasing over time, And then if we have a complex number, so it's got some imaginary component, but the real part is positive, then it will be an oscillatory mode, but is diverging. Okay, so this amplitude will be actually growing with time. All of these are plotted as a function of time. Okay, so if the real part is negative, we have these two different behaviors. If the real part is negative, it's convergent. Okay, so both of these are convergent. If the imaginary portion is zero, meaning that it's only a real component, then we have this overdamped motion, or I guess it could be critically damped. If the imaginary part is non-zero, then we have this oscillatory motion. Okay, and we can then compute the frequency, for example, of that damped sinusoidal motion. If the real part is positive, that means that we're going to have a mode that diverges. So both of these diverge, both of their amplitudes increase as a function of time. If the imaginary portion is zero, then it diverges monotonically like this, non-oscillatory, I mean. And if the imaginary portion is non-zero, then we will have some frequency associated with that, and it will be some oscillatory divergent motion. Okay, so anyway, at this point, I think we're ready now to jump into the dynamics of the aircraft and look at these equations and the results that are going to come out of our equations of motion for the aircraft.